describing the hair of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam and its length. We heard before that his hair sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not curled nor straight, it was curled straight. And here, Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the first hadith describes the length of the hair of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as reaching to half his ears. In the second hadith, Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha describes the limits of the length of the hair of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam فوق الجرمة, it didn't reach his shoulders. ودون الوفرة, it was below his ears, lobes. Above his shoulders and below his earlobes. Al-Ba'ad ibn Azib, again, the third Sahabi, describes the hair of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says that his hair used to touch his earlobes, shahmat al-udhni. Again, Anas confirms the same. Hani radiallahu ta'ala anha, daughter of Abu Talib, sister of Sayyidina Ali, Hani, cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet visited her in her home in Mecca for the conquest. She describes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he came to Mecca. She says, قدم مكة قدمة وله أربع غدائر. He had four plates. His hair sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was done in four plates. This hadith is also quoted at the end of this section. She says, رَأَيْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ ذَا مَخَائِرَ أَرْبَعَ with four side locks, four plates. The following hadith, Anas radiallahu ta'ala, and this is on the authority of Thabit al-Bunani, his student, Thabit al-Bunani. This is how we pronounce his name. Thabit al-Bunani is one of the major tabi'een. And he is an authority on Anas. He accompanied Anas for 40 years. He accompanied his teacher Anas for 40 years and was one of the greatest worshippers and ascetics. Anas radiallahu ta'ala describes the hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as being as long as reaching his half his ears. In all of these hadiths, we have differences. Differences are natural because the hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was growing. So, there's no contradiction. People saw him in different times. We don't have any single narration that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cut his hair. There is no one single narration to confirm that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cut his hair. Also, we don't have one single narration describing his hair in Mecca, except the reference to parting his hair. He used not to part his hair in Mecca, as we will read in the final hadith. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shaved his head. We have narrations, he shaved his head, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this happened the day of Hudaybiyah, the day of the truce of Hudaybiyah. Then the following day, Umratul Qadha. Then Hajjatul Wada'a, the farewell pilgrimage. Al-Imam Ali Qari says, فَلْيُعْتَبَ الْطُولُ وَالْقِصَرُ مِنْهُ بِالْمَسَافَاتِ وَاقِعَةِ مِنْهُ فِي تِلْكَ الْأَزْمِنَةِ. How long, how short his hair was, you just calculate. From one year to another, from Al-Hudaybiyah till Umrah al-Qadha, from Umrah al-Qadha till Hajjat al-Wada', from Hajjat al-Wada' till he died, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. The hadith number 30 here is on the authority of Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, the narrator of Abdullah ibn Abdullah ibn Uthba al-Mas'ud, student of Ibn Abbas. He describes here in more details the parting of the hair of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. At first, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to leave his hair, not to part it. He used to leave suddenly. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam to act differently from the people of Mecca. When he was in Mecca, he used to act differently. There were, for example, around the Kaaba, many idols. In some narrations, 360 idols. He sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam didn't pray towards the Kaaba while he was in Mecca. He prayed towards Al-Aqsa, Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. We believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings it back to the hands of Muslims, the authority of Muslims. So, may Allah give relief, inshallah, to people in Palestine and in Iraq, and give victory to all Muslims around the world. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam acted differently from the people of Mecca. When he came to Al-Madinah al-Munawwarah, he behaved in the same way. So, acting against the people of Mecca means acting like the people of the book. And since the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought a message and came with a book, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Muslims were closer to Christians and Jewish people than the polytheists, the associators and unbelievers of Mecca. But then, when coming to Al-Madinah al-Munawwarah, after a while, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted the Islamic identity to be distinguished from the Jewish and Christian identities. So, he changed many habits later on. And it's the sound kareem, he sallallahu ta'ala warned against imitating the people of the book. So it was established later on that you should not وَخَالِفُوا أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ تَصَرْوَلُوا وَأَتَزِلُوا وَخَالِفُوا أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ about wearing pants, trousers, or izar. The Sahaba wondered. The people of the book used to wear trousers, the Jewish people of Medina, not izar. The people of Mecca, Arabs, used to wear izar. So, what should they wear? He said, تَصَرْوَلُوا وَأَتَزِلُوا. You may wear both of them, but وَخَالِفُوا أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ act differently from the people of the book. So it's a major rule. When there's something that becomes a symbol of Christians or a habit for them, Muslims should not do it. Muslims should not wear it. Muslims should not practice it. Because the Islamic identity is different. Now they call it culture. There's nothing called culture in Islam. Most of what is described as being culture, food, drinks, dress codes are sunnahs of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is not. Are sunnahs. So changing culture from a country to another means changing the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in many areas. This is what they mean here sometimes by culture. I don't refer here to literature, to poetry, to writings as being part of the culture. But here, culture, they refer to food, they refer to dress, they refer to many practices in every country. People eat, for example, with sticks, people eat with their hands, people eat with spoons, people wear jeans, people wear coats, people wear qamis or izar. They call it now culture. In Islam, we have sunnahs of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam that we should maintain and we should not exchange for the local practices of certain peoples if it is against the sunnah. We have other examples. The Sahaba also asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam about the beard and the mustache. They say, in Ahl al-Kitab, يقصون عفارينهم ويوفرون سبالهم. The people of the book cut their beards and lit their mustaches. He صلى الله عليه وسلم commented to the Sahaba, قالوا قصوا سبالكم ووفروا عفارينكم. Lit your beard and cut your mustaches. Also another recommendation to act differently from the people of the book. And again here, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at the end, when he migrated to Al-Madinah, acted differently from the people of the book. The people of the book used to let their hair. They used to let their hair. He used to let his hair, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Mecca, but that was in Mecca. Now in Medina, Muslims should have a different identity from the identity of the people of the book. So he opted for parting his hair. Later on, he parted and he recommended to the Sahaba parting their hair differently from the people of the book. It is all sunnahs, of course. These things are sunnahs of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.